to Operation Self Reset. You're listening to episode number 19. What is going on, resetters? This is Operation Self Reset, the one and only place to change the person that you are right now to that person that you strive, you want, and you crave to be. Thank you, like always, for taking the time and listening to what I have to say. I hope it gives you some valuable information to inspire, change, transform, and maybe just give you that little bit extra to really excel your life in the direction that you want. Everybody kind of hates something about themselves. You know, they wish they could change a little bit, and I think that the information that I provide maybe can help you in that direction. So I thank you guys so much for taking the time for doing that. Before we get into today's interview, though, I want to take a few minutes and apologize. The last time I put out a podcast, I believe it was a couple of weeks ago, actually, and I did not give you guys warning of what was going on with me. And literally, I have been receiving 50, 60 emails from you guys, and I appreciate it so, so much. You guys have been asking me, Jake, where have you been? You know, we need these podcasts. Another person was like, Jake, did you disappear? And then it was like a long pause, and then she like scanned down like four or five paragraphs. If you disappeared, make sure you reappear so we can get some more podcasts. I thought that was really funny. So thank you, Stephanie, for that one. But today, though, I kind of want to just give you a cliff note version of what's been going on. I will, in the future here, give you guys a full detail of what was going on during the promotional process. Some of you may or may not know, I do have a full-time job. This is not my only job. This is more of a hobby. I love providing information to you guys. I love interviewing other people, not only for you guys, but for myself. I need to improve as much as you guys need to improve. And when it came time to juggling multiple things, you know, early August is when I found out there's a promotional exam in October. And I was thinking to myself, okay, this is going to be a tough one. You know, I talk about time management in a couple of our podcasts and, prioritizing your life and getting the most out of every single minute. So I was like, okay, I think I can do this. You know, I think I can handle the newborn. I think I can handle the bankruptcy, which I'm going through still currently. And I'll give you guys some updates on that in the upcoming podcast. And then I thought, okay, well, I can set aside time to study. And then I was thinking, well, can I keep doing the podcast? I'm like, yeah, I can keep doing the podcast. And then, of course, you know, just daily living and enjoying the summer. You know, it was still August, a lot going on. Weddings, wedding season, my gosh. Going up to family cottages and friend cottages and still living an active lifestyle and connecting with friends and family, which I personally believe is, you know, most important. Because without them, really, who do you have? You know, I mean, I really enjoy connecting with you guys, but no offense, I'm not seeing you guys come Christmas evening or Thanksgiving Day or anything like that. So I really wanted to stay connected with my roots. And I, as time progressed, I was really starting to get burnt out. You know, I was literally just getting worn down. And of course, I think the nerves and the emotions from the promotional exam that were coming up were really starting to get to me. And it's funny because I talk about, you know, staying positive, motivated, keeping inspired every single day, you know, starting your day on the right foot, you know, just having that strong mental mind. And yet, literally, when it came mid-September, I had a freak out moment. You know, I really was down on myself. I was really, you know, kind of debating, like, am I ready for this test? You know, am I ready to go? And to give you a background on this test, it's not just a, you know, traditional, you know, here are a couple books and have at it. You know, the job that I'm in, there are a lot of national standards, and then there are a lot of internal standards, and they differ from one another. The thing is, I needed to memorize both, not only the national standards, but what we do and operate. And that was very difficult because there was a lot of condescending answers and questions and stuff. So it was a lot of battling between the books. And literally, honestly, this is no joke, in all the paperwork of all the books, all that stuff, it was about 5,000 pages of information. And I'm not saying, oh, poor Jake, gosh, you're so crazy awesome, good for you. No, I'm just saying it was a lot of work. And I'm proud of myself for getting through it. The test came October 1st, which was this past Tuesday. And I was really, really nervous. But that was okay, because I feel that nerves is a good way of clarifying and purifying your mind. You know, it keeps you very sharp. You know, if you're kind of relaxed and, you know, just kind of like, whatever, your mind's all over the place. But I feel if you're nervous, your mind is really focused. So I'm okay with that. When I was going through the test, you know, I was trying to take each question as an individual mini test. But it was one of those tests that said, And you would read these answers, and literally all four of them were like right on. Of course, you could deduct two of the answers. The other two were so close. I mean, it was so ridiculous. I was pretty much playing 50-50 the whole way through. So let's just hope that my guessing strategy worked out. Everything I saw, I have seen before. But when it came time to the test, I think like you guys can relate. You kind of go, gosh, Where did that come from? I remember it in your skin, your brain, and you feel the pressure of the time ticking away. You feel the pressure of other people in the room getting up and handing in their tests. You know, it's just an overwhelming experience. But I'm glad it's over with, so I apologize so much for putting you guys on the back burner, but it was something that I had to do for myself, and I think that's a good life lesson for you guys out there too. You guys are going to encounter things when you just have a full plate, you know, and everything around you is just going berserk, and you want to complete everything. You want to see your friends and family. You want to do this. You want to go there. You want to do this for yourself. You know, you want to go see your kids play, but yeah, you got to work or whatever. You need to prioritize your life. And for me, it was doing the promotional exam. I felt that would really help me grow as an individual. And it was something that I feel that is inside of me when it comes to a challenge. I love challenges. I really enjoy the battle, you know, the really the competition between me and the test. And I really put my heart and soul into it, and we'll see what happens. So it's out of my control now. But I hope that you guys also have that little desire inside of you. And I hope that when something does come into your plate or up to you and a challenge, I hope you accept it and you hit it full on. I hope you don't, you know, go, oh, well, there's a test coming up. I could study. I'll study a little bit. I really hope you dedicate yourself. And that's tough to do. And it's easier said than done, of course, because you might be a single parent. You might have a lot of going on. You might, you know, be, you know, bathing, watching, you know, enjoying reading, putting your kid to sleep. And by that time, you're exhausted and all that stuff. All I'm saying is just try your best. And that's all you can do. So, that's my two cents. I'll go more into detail on this topic in the next couple of podcasts, just because I want to share with you guys what I did to prepare. And you can relate the topics and the tips that I use personally to get myself ready, I think, into your daily lives, or maybe to events that come up or challenges or whatever. I hope you guys maybe would find some value out of that. So let's roll into today's content. Today is about a nuclear weapon explosion that happened in the United States. And some of you may or may not know, in the 1980s, there was a lot of missiles, nuclear missiles, that were planted around the country. There was 18 nuclear missiles in Arizona. There was 18 in, I'm looking at my notes here, Kansas. And there's 18 nuclear weapons in Arkansas. And these weapons were armed with, put it this way, a bomb that was multiple times the damage of Hiroshima, and which is incredible in itself, because I think that everybody has seen the pictures of Hiroshima. They have seen the videos and the, you know, the cars going down the street, and it's just, I mean, literally cities are leveled. And to imagine a bomb even twice as big as that is unremarkable. So let's get into today's content. His name is Greg Devlin, and he was working on the Titan II missile in Arkansas when it exploded. It is a remarkable story, and I know you guys will find some really good benefit and value out of it. It not only talks about his story and, you know, the things that occurred that day, but how his life progressed from there, and not knowing where his life would be if he was to perish. You know, he felt that the reason why he was still on this earth is because of creating his family. But the remarkable thing is where his story took him. And as you guys know, nationally, October is National Bully Month. And I think you and myself have seen the videos on national news, local news, on the internet, YouTube videos or whatever. Kids bullying, you know, that's a big topic. It's a hot topic. And some of you may or may not have experienced that personally, maybe when you're a younger child. But it is something that is very well known now, and which is good. You know, people are understanding it more and more. There's more programs, there's more things that are going on about it. And the reason why I bring up National Bully Month is because Greg is part of this new project called the Neon Tiki Tribe, and it's a collection of books that helps the younger generation, kids, learn about doing good things, you know, about helping other people instead of being the bullies, or you know, when it comes to games, you know, how to be a good sportsmanship instead of a poor one, you know, and it's pretty cool stuff that he's doing. But before we get into that, here is his story. It's unbelievable. Really enjoy it and listen to it, and maybe on your own, investigate the Titan II explosion. It's pretty wild what this country did during the 80s there in preparation of a nuclear war. So take a couple minutes here, enjoy the interview, and we will catch you on the other side. All right, hey guys, and welcome back to the podcast. Today we have on a very special guest. His name is Greg Devlin. You guys probably don't know about him, but you might have heard his story. In 1980, there was a huge explosion in Arkansas, about 1 hour away from Little Rock, and it was from the Titan II explosion. Greg is a survivor from it. Greg, first off, thanks for coming on the podcast. Really do appreciate your time and sharing your story.
Thanks, Jacob. Thanks for inviting me.
No problem. And, you know, to get everybody up to speed, and, you know, unlike myself, I did a lot of research, and I've read about this article and about what happened. It's an unbelievable story. Do you mind taking us through that day and kind of giving us a little bit of background, you know, who you are and how did you get involved in a nuclear missile, if you don't mind?
Absolutely. And I'm not sure how far back you want to go, but I joined the Air Force in 1977, right out of high school, and went in open, what they call open, where literally the Air Force could almost put me anywhere they wanted. And, you know, they give you a few choices. But I wind up in Titan II missiles, and that was the fuel systems for Titan II missiles.
Okay.
Which I didn't know anything about as a young kid, but it sounded interesting, sounded exciting, and it sounded important, a Titan II missile. So with that background, I had been in the service about 3 years, a little over 3 years, and you know, by then I was a senior airman, and I got a call. We were the second shift guys, and we got a call, and just to give you, take a step back, to give you an idea, what we did was the Titan II missiles. There were 54 of them, 18 in Arizona, 18 in Kansas, and 18 in Arkansas. And we were the fuel systems, liquid fuel systems technicians. And so to keep a Titan II on alert, meaning it's ready to go if should the country ever call and need that awful power. I mean, just amazing power from a warhead like that. But thankfully, we've never needed it. But so to keep those birds on alert, what would happen is from time to time, the fuels, which are so corrosive, would eat the seals and then start to leak. So if they started to leak, then the tank pressure inside would start to drop, and the commanders would notice that, and then they would call the PTS guys. Propellant transfer systems guys, and I was one of them. So we had got give a little more on that. So they would call us out. We would come, if it was a bad enough leak, we would come out and then do an entire recycle operation, which is we would pull all the fuels above ground into tankers, and then they would, to give a short description, replace the seals inside. And then they would fill the Titan II back again and pressurize the tanks, and it would put it back on alert, so it was ready to go. So with that information, we had got a call that a really bad situation had developed, and we didn't know all the details, but one of our technicians had dropped a socket, and it was the last step. All they were doing was pressurizing that tank, and then they put the cap back on, kind of like your gas cap in your car.
Sure.
And then safety wire. Well, they had to torque this to a certain spec, and as they started to torque that cap, the socket fell off of this picture, a 3-foot-long ratchet, and a socket that's 9 pounds.
Oh, and wow.
So the socket falls off of the ratchet and bounces on the platforms, and these platforms are designed so that really nothing should get past it, no matter what. And it bounced, and when it did, it bounced toward the missile. The guy that dropped it was literally grasping at it, trying to catch it. And it bounced towards the missile, and it hit just perfect where the platforms come down, and they kind of make a pie-shaped circle around the outer shell of that Titan II missile. And the missile skin being a very thin aluminum, and then picture a black rubber, say, boot on the outside of the platform, they squeeze just enough on both sides for that heavy socket to squish through there. And when it did, it fell a long way, and at the base of the missile is a they call it a thrust ring. So the thrust ring holds the Titan II upright, and it bounced off of that thrust ring, and it could have went in a lot of different directions, but it went bounced right into the bottom stage one fuel tank, and knocked a hole in the side of the tank. Yeah. So created a very bad situation. The tank had 11,800 gallons of this very, very hazardous fuel.
And that's per missile.
Per missile. Oh, wow. Absolutely. Yeah. And each one of them, you know, you know, 18 warheads and 18 missiles in Arkansas, you know, you never knew for sure whether that was a real warhead or if you want to call it a dummy warhead. But
sure.
We're under the assumption they were all real. There's no sense to have a dummy in there. But anyway, so he knocked a hole in there, starts pouring fuel out of the thing, and becomes a really bad situation really quick. And that was the first shift guys. They were kind of finishing up for the day. And so we were second shift when they called us in. To expand on that story, then we get the call and they said, listen, this is an extremely hazardous situation. In fact, we don't know how bad it is. You know, so this is a volunteer only mission. If you want to go, you can, but you don't have to. And, you know, we were the fuel systems guys, and we you know, had pride in what we did, and sure. I felt like it was very important. And
you're a younger guy. How old were you at the time?
I was 21 at the time. Sure. So, you know, I just turned 21 about 3 weeks earlier. And so, you know, you're there and you say, of course we're going. But, you know, we got to figure out how to fix the thing. So we go out there and as we get out there on the site, you know, just fast forward a little bit, over a period of a few hours while the Air Force and Strategic Air Command, SAC headquarters, trying to figure out what to do, they sent us in, and my partner and I, Rex Huckel, we had to cut through a fence. The command crew had completely evacuated from this silo. There was no one in it. And, you know, the largest nuclear warhead the United States has ever owned is sitting on top of this missile. The situation's getting worse. They're losing tank pressure. They're worried about the missile is going to collapse. So they're looking at options they wanted to get us down into what they call a blast lock area. It's kind of a bathroom, a big bathroom. And on one door to your right is a 6,000-pound blast lock door behind it is a tunnel that runs about 120 feet out to the Titan II missile. And if you made a left, if you were in that same blast lock area and you look to your left, there's a 6,000-pound blast lock door. If you open that one, you go inside of the command center, okay?
Okay.
Separated by this thing they call a blast lock area. And there's a panel inside of that, a vapor detector panel. And they wanted us to get that far to see what that panel said. That would give them some indications of how bad the fuel vapors and the it was inside of that Titan II missile right down in the silo. So the first two guys were myself and Rex, and we cut the fence. We broke through this portal door where you would normally enter a code and go in that way with the command crew there. So we broke through that, went down two and a half stories there, and started to pump open a 6,000-pound blast lock door. So as the door, they finally get, we get to that point. We're at a point where they have to bring us back because we'd be running out of air. They send the next two guys in. They enter two doors like that, 6,000-pound doors. They get to that panel. the panel looks, it's pegged, lack of better terms, it's pegged out. So it looks real bad. They call back to give the command, SAC command, all the information. And they said, come back immediately. So these two guys, Jeff Kennedy and David Livingston, come back as soon as within seconds of them getting back topside. So right there next to the silo door almost. The silo exploded. The Titan II missile exploded in the silo. Jeez. And to give you an idea, the blast, it blew a 740-ton silo door that's held down by four great big hydraulic pins. It blew it 700 feet off the complex.
Wow.
You know, and I was, you know, in my, well, really, not just me, but there were a bunch of people that were at that gate, you know, the PTS crew and the commanders and stuff, and literally, say, 80 or 90 feet from the silo door. So when it exploded, it was like standing, to me, it was like the loudest bang I ever heard in my life. It was like a massive concussion of air. The first thing to hit me was just a concussion of air and wind, and it blew me backwards. I had no control of any body parts. I just went flipped on my back, and I started sliding up the road. Picture flames, steel, glowing steel, concrete that looks like lava blowing past you. And you know, Jacob, the only thought I had in my mind was, it's over. I just hope it's not painful.
Oh, yeah, sure. Like, you had enough time to think there for a second.
Just a split second,
yeah.
Right?
Huh.
So as I'm sliding up the road, just through my left eye kind of cracked open as I was sliding and seeing all this steel and concrete going past me. But anyway, so as I'm sliding, I'm getting faster and faster, and then all of us, and I'm picturing I'm going to slam into something, and all of a sudden I come to a dead stop. Hmm. And I was stunned, burnt, dazed, confused, and I had two screams in my ear so loud. You know, I ask people, I don't know if you believe in guardian angels or not, but I had two screams in my ear so loud it scared me. I rolled to the left to see who was there. Picture, it's 3 o'clock in the morning, 3:01 in the morning. Sure. I don't know if it was a full moon, but it was. Dark, but it was slightly lit up because of the moon, and there's no one there.
Wow.
There's no one next to me. So within seconds, I mean, it scared me so bad. I jumped up and I started to run. And now imagine this. I have this rubber, for lack of better terms, kind of looks like an astronaut suit, but anyway, it's halfway up to my waist because I had been in a suit. To get in there. But anyway, so I'm running with this thing hanging off of me, off my legs and stuff. And I got approximately 5 or 6 steps away from where I was. And a chunk of concrete as big as bigger than a car, half as big as a bus, hits the ground behind me.
Jeez.
And, you know, I didn't know what it was hitting the ground behind me, but I could feel the earth move. I was scared. I was like, just keep running, man.
Yeah.
So as I'm running, a piece of the steel rebar, about 30 foot long strands of steel rebar were hanging out of concrete. It hit me in the ankle, took me down, and then, you know, I rolled over and looked at this shadow of this thing that was kind of pointed, jagged piece of concrete, and I thought I was laying next to the Titan II missile. So that's what I survived.
Jeez, can you mind telling people? I mean, that was an amazing chain of events. One of the people that you were, or the second crew that replaced you, one of them perished. Is that correct?
Well, he was actually with us out there.
He was.
Yes, he was the myself and Rex were the first two to break. And you know, Eric Schlosser, who wrote Command and Control, said, "Greg, you and Rex Huckel may be the only two guys in history to actually break into a nuclear missile complex."
Right.
Keeping in mind that it was at the orders of our bosses, but
right.
Trying to get in to help the situation. But, David Livingston was a guy that, he was a friend of mine. he was from Ohio also. I'm originally from Cincinnati, Ohio. And so, yeah, he died about 12 hours after the missile explosion because he'd been hit with a chunk of concrete that penetrated his suit and his stomach lining. And then flames burned the sacs of his lungs. So he actually died, my understanding is, of a heart attack. Because his lungs weren't putting oxygen into his blood.
Wow. And what were all the injuries that you sustained?
Burns on my second and third degree burns on my face, neck, back, and both hands.
Wow.
Broke my eardrum, my right eardrum, and then shattered my left ankle. They put two pins in my ankle, and it cut off two-thirds of my Achilles tendon.
Jeez.
I was in a hospital for about 10 days.
And what are the effects that you have today?
Well, one of the injuries was my lower back. I had a, I think they call it compression fracture of the fourth lumbar vertebrae. But what happened was as my back got worse, when I left the military, I was a 50% disabled veteran. And now I'm 100% disabled veteran. And it's most of my pain in my life now is because I've had six major back surgeries.
Wow.
And what happens is they're in a sense, they're kind of failed back surgeries because my spine would never fuse. Hmm. I have six rods in my back with, six great big screws in my back with two rods running down the back of my spine. But I have a plate on the front with three screws. And then I have two separate spinal stimulators in me, one in my left hip. It runs a wire to my spinal cord, and then one in my right hip that runs two wires in the base of my back into the muscles. But what they found is I had a very, very severe case of osteoporosis.
Okay.
And my body's ability to absorb vitamin D, that's where the problem's at. So my surgeons all said, if your body doesn't maintain vitamin D, then – and that – you know, may or may not have been caused by the inhaling all those fuels. They said, no matter how much calcium you take in your life, your body doesn't use it. You have to have a vitamin D level that'll support the calcium. So anyway, what's happened is rods and screws have all wobbled loose. My spine is back crushing the nerve bundles again. And, and then there's movement there. That's the pain, is because there's movement down there. So,
wow. You
know. But there's people who are way, way worse than me in a sense in life. So,
right. You know, No, for sure. And we'll touch on that in a second. And probably the people listening are like, well, what amazing story. What does this have to do with Operation Self Reset, changing the person you are to the person you want to be? So, but before we dive into all these deep questions that I have for you and your new outlook on life, I just want to clarify and get a better understanding of the missile head. I kind of gather that it was one of the most powerful nuclear weapons that the U.S. has ever made to this day, correct?
Yes.
Yes. And that's per missile. So 18. So 18 in three different states.
Yes.
Wow. And I heard that the missile head had about the power of 9 Hiroshimas. Is that correct too?
100 times as powerful as Hiroshima.
Wow.
It's a 9 megaton warhead. That's what was put on the Titan IIs. And
jeez. Yeah. And this was for our defense. This was for America during the Cold War in the 80s, correct? I mean, kind of a defense mechanism. If things went haywire, we would launch them off to whoever and take care of business. That was a plan, correct?
Yes. They were a massive deterrent. And, during that Cold War time frame, it was, you know, us and Russia and a lot of politics there, but
sure. Well, awesome. Not really awesome, but unbelievable story. It's glad to be talking to you, in the flesh, because it sounds like you could have disintegrated by the amount of things that happened on that evening there. Let's talk about, first off, that guardian angel or that voice that you thought you heard. There's a lot of stories about people go on covert missions or people in just general, you know, weird situations. They feel like they have an encounter with somebody like that. They hear a voice. They feel a sense that somebody's around them, or they just get that weird feeling. When you reflect on your story and you feel like that somebody screamed at you and you looked, nobody was there, but either way you got up and trucked forward, and luckily you did because that concrete block fell in your spot. Right. What do you say to people when they say, oh, that's, you know, a bunch of BS, or I don't believe in that? I mean, what's your understanding that you felt during that time and when you can reflect on it. Can you talk us through that a little bit?
I say this because when I tell that story, it gives me goosebumps when I tell it. It was 33 years ago, just a few days ago on September 19th. It was 33 years ago that happened. And I'm, in fact, when I'm telling you this now, I have this vibe that that was a guardian angel for me. And I don't have any questions about it. I know it. This scream was so loud and overpowering. There was not a soul there. So I knew, to me, it was like, oh my gosh, you have to run immediately. And, sure. And then because of what happened, because of that concrete hitting the ground behind me, I just had this, I just know that that thing was coming down on top of me, and the power, the spirit, the guardian angel,
sure,
that's the only way I can describe it, was there. I have no doubt about that, because I truly would not be here talking to you. And I'm okay with people that it's never happened to, so
sure.
You know, if they say, oh, that, you know, that's crazy, or I don't believe it, and I'm okay with that. I just know for me personally that's what happened. You know, I can tell you from experience that happened to me.
Sure. Now, going off of that, feeling like you had a guardian angel there, obviously, like you said, you're so blessed to be talking to me today. What did you find after your recovery and the multiple surgeries and everything that happened afterwards, and the people interviewing you and talking to you and all that stuff? What have you found, I guess, as your personal, like second life per se? Like, what did you change differently about yourself? Were there bad habits that you said, I'm done doing that, now I'm going to live my life of this? Was there anything that you found within yourself that you just feel so grateful to be on this planet alive, talking to people? Is there anything that you changed within yourself?
Well, most of the people that have known me, I have many of them that are still around me from the military days. So they knew me back when I was a kid and, I went in the military, like I say, at 17. Yeah. And my parents had to sign for me. And so knowing me from a young age to today, most of them, I believe if you ask people that knew me back then to now, first, we all mature as we get older. You know, you take sure. any 30 years later and they would be a more mature person, hopefully.
Right. Yeah.
hopefully we get, you know, that. You have to get smarter as you get older because you start to lose your faculties.
Right.
but most people, if you ask them about me, I believe you would get a response that I've always been a happy, upbeat, positive person in life.
Good.
And I think a lot of that was my parents when I was, growing up. You know, they were the kind of people that said, if you set your mind to do something, you can do it. You have to make the decisions to do things. And so, man, not to say I'm perfect by no means,
sure.
Not even close, but I've always been a pretty positive person. What I've learned as you go through life and then being a pretty positive person, when I survived that, I kept asking myself, and I was young, I was like, man, why was I spared? Why did that scream happen? So I used to ask the question, why?
Right.
Why me? Why me? And, so going through life, and then, I was married. My wife and I were married very young. She was 16 and I was 18 when I just turned 18. So when we got married and been married now 36 years, actually Wednesday.
Oh, congrats.
So, young kids, I seen as I've gotten older, the biggest blessing obviously is my family and my kids and my grandkids now. So that's what I look at as my nut, that's why God still has me here.
Sure.
And this is just personal opinions I'm telling you here, but that's why I'm still here. Was number one was for that. I am working on a, and when I say I have, you know, Josh and one of them, but we have an awesome team that's working on a very powerful new children's project. And so I would like to think that that's another reason why I'm still here, what that represents. And, you know, I know we're going to, we'll talk about it a little bit later.
Yeah. Yeah. No, but that's cool though. You kind of have clarity of understanding the reasonings why you have certain things in your life. And like you said, you know, new projects that came up that at the time when this happened, you had no idea was ever going to involve into doing a children's series and, you know, focusing yes. on stuff like that. But, you know, going back to being raised as a positive person and, you know, it's one thing that I also too was raised very positive. And, you know, like you said, you know, you can achieve anything in your life if you put your mind to it and things like that. And there are people that are listening that were not raised that way, you know, that were not raised with that mindset or the way of, you know, believing in themselves. And they're discovering that right now.
Yes.
But, you know, you are a man that is in chronic pain every single day, correct?
Exactly.
Yes. And how do you utilize that power of positive thinking towards your ailments, the things that are holding you back, to keep you upbeat, positive, you know, to sit on Skype right now with me and talk so passionately and so openly and so enthusiastically, but yet your body is just, you know, tearing away at you. How does that mind work to keep positive even though that pain is going on? Do you mind sharing that for the people that don't have that ability or have not experienced that position, mm-hmm. that they have the ailments, but yet they know positive thinking can help in that recovery process?
Oh yeah. Let's see here. How do I explain that? First, I have a father that's in a nursing home that I'm very close with, that I see, oh my gosh, out of 365 days a year, I probably see him 345.
Wow, that's awesome.
And it's not because I have to, it's because I want to. I'm real close with him. And I mean, I'm close with all my family, but the way so seeing, and not just this, but I'll just use this as a reference. If you'd go into a nursing home today, you will see people in there, not just, you know, elderly people. You'll see some, you know, I'm 54, so you'll see people that are 40 or 37 that have had strokes.
Sure.
And or maybe heart attacks or something. And so when you will notice, almost always in life, you will notice someone that's worse off than you are, meaning way worse pain, way worse situation. And so for me, I go, oh my gosh, you know, I'm still standing upright, and you know, I'm talking to Jacob today, and there's people that can't talk, there's people that can't see, there's people that can't, you know, they have ailments, and some things are just so horrible. They're, you know, mine would be small compared to theirs. So I feel blessed that I'm able to do things that I am able to do. And, you know, I was raised that, your situation, no matter what it is, it is whatever it is, and you can look at it negatively and make just a really, oh, it's horrible and poor me and whatever. And it might be a really bad situation. Or you could take the same thing and say, because you and I see it, we see it, it's out there where people that are in real bad situations that are actually inspiring other people. And you look at them, you're going, these people are amazing. Mm-hmm. So, and that's a frame of mind. I believe that's a frame of mind. Is the glass half full or is it half empty? So I was raised that way. I feel lucky that I have that outlook on life. And, I would say anything along those lines to the people that, are in a bad situation, that first you can do something about it. You can, no matter how bad it is, if you take a positive outlook on it, it will be better off than you taking that negative outlook. Mm-hmm. So that's how I would try to help them people.
Oh yeah, for sure. And you're hit it on the head. I mean, just the positive outlook. And you know, not to say this, but you know, your ailments are what they are. You know, they right. tried everything they could to help you recover, to get better, you know, to straighten out your back, to relieve yes. some of the pain. But it didn't take, you know, your body didn't take the calcium, and that return didn't really help the surgeries, and it kind of all rolled into one. And you understand that. And there's nothing else, I guess, they probably could maybe do more surgeries or do some other things to help you recover. But at the end of the day, they tried everything they could. Now it's your turn to really try to heal yourself from the inside out. And the only way you can really do that is to keep a positive mindset, you know, keep on pushing ahead, you know, keep on enthusiastic and not show, you know, the poor me, you know, my gosh, I'm in so much pain. Please help me reaching out. You know, you live your day to the fullest every single day. You're blessed to be alive and you can hear it through your voice. I mean, if for the people listening, I know you guys can hear Greg's voice just feeling so enthusiastic. Not knowing you from the beginning of this podcast, right away, you were just peppy, alert, you know, interested in telling your story. And to now knowing everything that happened to you, you would still think that nothing's wrong with you just because you're so happy-go-lucky, a great, great individual. And that kind of rolls me into the next part of your phase of your life of reasoning why you're still on this earth. And it has to deal with your project that you're doing. And I think this is a great thing. And if you wouldn't mind taking the time and sharing kind of what you're doing today for the children of the future.
Oh my gosh, this is a very powerful children's project that we're about to introduce to the world. It's called the Worldwide Neon Tiki, T-I-K-I, Tribe, worldwide. So neontikitribe.com is the website. But just to give you an idea, one of the projects we are getting ready for next month, I'll just tell you about that real quick, which is a Stop the Bullying. So neontikitribe.com/stop-bullying is this link to what we're doing. But we've created by the way, Tiki, T-I-K-I, in our story, is a thoughtful, intelligent, kind individual. A thoughtful, intelligent, kind individual.
And so he's a character. He's like an animated character or a character in this book series? Okay, sure.
Yes, there's four of them. There's four characters, three males and a female. By the way, the female is the smartest one in the group. and by the way, I have a wife and four daughters, so that I learned that a long time ago.
Yeah. Well, in your case, I agree then. I agree.
But so what we did was we wanted to create superheroes for children that were educational at the end of the story. So an educational superhero. So what we did was we've created a line of children's books, which, by the way, we just completed number 5. And let me give you an idea of the stories that we're doing. Book 1 was Tiki Beach Battle, and it's an environmental ocean cleanup story. Book number 2 is Dog Rescue Mission. And that would sound like, a little dog was lost. So, but the background of that is the little boy lost his family dog, but he made a mistake because he told his parents a lie when they asked him where the dog was. So the Neon Tikis, the good guys in our storyline, and a kid named Greg, that with his dog Sniff Sniff. So anyway, the Neon Tikis and Greg and Sniff Sniff said, tell this little boy, yeah, we're gonna help you find your dog. And so they help him get through the forest and battle the bad guys. And by the end, and I don't want to give away all the stories here, but so Dog Rescue Mission is about honesty. Book number 3 is Bullies Playground Push Around. And it's a story where a little girl gets bullied over her glasses in school. So that's the third book. Book number 4 is The Rise of Kunatos, the ultimate bad guy. By the way, there's a group of bad Tikis called the Ku Tiki tribe, the Ku Tiki. So anyway, Kunatos is the worst of all of them. And this is about perseverance. It's about never giving up in life. And then our fifth book is called Strangers, a Ku Kidnapping. And it's just like the title. So it's to keep children safe so they don't get in cars with people they don't know. They don't go with people they don't know. A stranger danger type of
story. Yeah, sure.
Right? So 6 stories are done. Five stories are done there. We have 3 more coming out this year. We have a sportsmanship book. We have a fire safety book.
Cool.
It's just a really cool kids project. And one other thing, Jacob, I just want to let you know, we are the first children's book series in America to use a font called Dyslexi. And dyslexia is for children. One out of five children in America struggle to read because of dyslexia. So, you know, 80% of kids do well in school. 20% struggle with reading, which is the basis for learning. You know, if letters were flipping and floating and moving around on you, and by the way, I'm not dyslexic, and none of my partners are dyslexic, but we've found from our books that when we put them with people, and we'll find this out because they'll start to read it and they'll go, oh my gosh, these books are so easy to read. But anyway, this is a special font in our book that was created, and you know, and we actually paid a little extra to have, you know, if we were thinking just profit, we could have not used it, just sure. Created a children's book series. But we said, we want to take this project, let's take it to the nth degree, make it as best as it can be, and, you know, help kids learn how to read. So it's a very exciting children's project, and I would like to believe that that's one of my purposes for still being here.
Sure. And how did you get involved in this? How did you start up? You know, why did you think about this? What was the theory behind it?
Well, you know, I always say things happen for a reason.
Sure. Yeah. So do I.
I believe that. I don't know if I'd say it this strong, but there are no accidents in life. I believe that things happen for a reason. I believe we meet people for a reason. We, you know, whether it's a reason, a season, you know, a lifetime.
Oh, yeah. Sure, sure.
So I believe that. And so the Tiki's actually years ago got started. I worked at the Kennedy Space Center when I got out of the military. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Did a similar job. It was life support. So we kept people safe, the guys at the Space Center, when they would deal with the same fuels that the Titan used, they would use on the shuttle in a lot smaller quantities. But we would help them stay safe by life support, by keep working on the suits, putting them in the suits, putting the backpacks on them, maintaining all the equipment. But years ago, remember when the shuttle blew up?
Yeah.
The first one blew up. I was laid off after that, and I went into a tree transplant moving business called Tremendous Trees. But long story short, I used to move thousands of palm trees in Florida. If any died, I'd give you a new one, no questions asked. And I used one that had died. Instead of hauling it to the dump, I carved this tiki for fun and painted it bright neon colors, and I put a pair of sunglasses on it. And I happened to live on a busy street there in Titusville, Florida. And, you know, because of the shuttle, you'd have so many visitors that were coming by to see the shuttle launches. Yeah. Well, they would wind up driving past my house. And, oh, my gosh, Jacob, we had two colleges come by, their photography classes. We had the newspaper come by.
Wow.
We had tourists stopping by. And it was all over this neon tiki. And, you know, I had a bell go off in my head right then. I said, wait a second. This is a country that created a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle,
right?
In a sewer system in New York. I said, I bet I could create a kids series with neon tikis with laser powers, and let's make them educational characters instead of bad guy. I mean, I shouldn't say bad guys. Most superheroes are good guys,
right?
But let's create a educational line of children's books that qualify for the school systems and the home or television. That's our goal. Anyway, that's a little bit of the background story.
No, that's really cool. You know, like you said, I mean, things don't happen by accident, and it's kind of cool to hear that story of, yeah, you know what, you just decided to carve something. Next thing you know, you put it out front. People start taking pictures. Then it hits you. It rolls into helping kids. You know, it's a really cool. On the way the things kind of happen. It's always interesting, you know, if I was to pick this book up in a Barnes & Noble or wherever, or I see it on Amazon, I would think, oh, you know, cool, you know, wow, interesting. You know, it's about, you know, helping little kids, about, you know, the things that you just spoke of. But understanding the true story behind it, of how it evolved, and, you know, you're a part of this, it really hits home the topics, the things that you're trying to do. And like you said earlier on, I mean, maybe it's one of the things why you're here on this earth, or it's not, or whatever, but
right.
Either way, you're using your time for good. You know, you're not
right.
Wasting your time. You're not, still talking about that horrific day. Obviously you do, for good reasons, It's amazing the process that you went through get this out to the public, and hopefully, and I think you got something going here. I think it's really interesting.
That's awesome, man. I appreciate that, and I'm sure our team does also.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, it's these books are launched already, correct? You can find them in Amazon?
Absolutely. They're on, in fact, we just released our Amazon, the Kindle editions, which are out there. And by the way, Neon Tiki Tribe, if they look wherever they get their iPad apps or their Kindle apps, Amazon, if you go to Amazon for wherever you get your apps at, if you type in Neon Tiki Tribe, the dog rescue mission is free to anyone with an iPad or Kindle right now. They can literally download it to their iPad or Kindle for free. And one other thing I want to throw in there, just so you knew, we also created teaching guides that qualified at the state and national level, what they call the core standards. We literally have teaching guides for the first books, first four books have just been completed, and our children's books have been translated into Spanish and Dutch, because that's where the font came from, was the Netherlands. But Spanish and Dutch. So our books are in three languages right now. I shouldn't say right now. They've been translated. And within the next probably 30 days, they'll be available on your Kindles or your iPads. You'll be able to get them in three separate languages. So really good stuff, man, is coming. That's what makes us worldwide, is when we start to go into all the other languages.
Oh, for sure. And where do you see the end of this project? I mean, is it more books? Are you guys going to start making, you know, things to help kids with, you know, other situations that they encounter? Is this going to keep on going?
I think so. I think once you create the brand name and the world knows who you are, that it'll spread into many areas. We think it's going to start. Our goal is to write 100. By the way, the Berenstain Bears were 73 to 74 books, somewhere in there. And our writers said we can write 100 stories. So cool. Do everything from cyberbullying and, you know, don't be a graffiti artist, be a graphic artist.
You know? There you go. Yeah.
You know, if you're big and tough and strong, don't use it for gangbanging. Use it to become a defender of people that aren't quite as strong as you. So take negatives and turn them into positives in life. That's our goal with the series, is to have fun, hopefully wind up in the school systems, and then literally, who knows, you know, TVs, movies, books, a lot of different areas, you know.
Sure. You know, having a younger child now, you know, he's too young to even read or understand what a book is yet. But that's cool. That's cool that you're doing something different. You know, you're given another tool for the toolbox, and any more information and great stories that we can, you know, tell our younger generation about how to become good citizens, good people, I think is well worth the praise. So congrats on that success, and congrats on the book too that you are in. It's called Command and what is it called?
And Control.
Command
and Control, and it's written by Eric Schlosser, who's awesome. Well, he's become a friend of mine through this 6-year process. Great guy and investigative journalist kind of a person.
He wrote that book, Fast Food Nation, too, correct?
Yeah, absolutely. Cool. Yes. Very, very powerful book that's out there.
Yeah, and we did not hit on all of the politics that were involved in it, but he really dives into a lot of the underlying secrets and other revealing things about that Titan II explosion and other nuclear warheads around America.
Right.
But with that said, Greg, thank you so much for your time. Really do appreciate it. Anything else you want to say before I let you go?
Thanks, Jacob. Just a reminder to everyone, the neontikitribe.com/stopbullying, and that'll take you straight to our bullying campaign for next month, for October of 2013.
Perfect. And I will put that in the show notes, so the people listening, just head on over to Operation Self Reset and you guys will find all the links that Greg talked about. Greg, it's an honor. Take care, keep positive, and keep on spreading the word. I appreciate your time.
Thanks, Jacob.
Thanks again to Greg for coming on the podcast. I appreciate you sharing your story. And for the people that are listening, I hope that inspired you a little bit. You know, it's amazing how one minute you can be literally in the hospital, everything's wrong, you just survived a horrible explosion, all that stuff. And you look back and you find yourself now writing children's books and helping out the next generation. It's pretty remarkable. We'll touch more on that in a second. But again, Greg is in the new book, Command and Control. The author is Eric Schlossinger. You guys may know it from Fast Food Nation. Now, that is a book, too, that I would like to dive into a little more. Fast Food Nation, very interesting and kind of gives you a background on the fast food industry. I don't know why I had to plug that. I personally read it. I thought it was kind of a cool book. So if you guys have any doubts about fast food, check it out. But that's not what this podcast is about. So back to changing and transforming our lives. So Greg, you know, told us about his story and talked about how, you know, when he was at that age, he had no idea, you know, what was the reason why he lived. You know, he said a guardian angel, and he truly believes that. And like he said, you know, you can believe it or not, and that's truly up to you. I personally believe in it. I believe that there are people out watching out for us. You know, I believe that, you know, when it's your time, and when it isn't, it isn't. And certain events will happen in your life. And I don't want to get too deep on that because I know some people have very strong beliefs, but it just shows that when you do have that ability to live past a horrible thing in your life, no matter if it's a disease, a car crash, some other traumatic incident, it shows you never know where your life is going to take you. And instead of focusing on that tragic, tragic day, instead of going, oh my gosh, you're reliving it every single day, take a second and think to yourself, why is it that I'm living? You know, what's the reasoning behind it? And Greg never knew that he would be writing children's books. It wasn't when he was in the Navy thinking to himself, man, I can't wait till I'm older so I can write all these children books about a tiki tribe. You know, he developed into it. He found it, you know, and from you, from what you can hear from him, he's really passionate about it. You know, he really enjoys helping these children. He really enjoys, you know, writing these books and trying to instill good values into the younger generation. And again, like always, you know, this is not a plug. I didn't get Greg on here just for this. I got him on here because he does have a remarkable story. He has a remarkable process that he personally went through. You know, how he stayed positive throughout all of his stuff. He's in pain every single day. And to be positive is remarkable. You know, some people have very they take it in a different direction. You know, they become very difficult to talk to. They become very sheltered. They're not open. But Greg is one that transformed his life into what he enjoys, and that's writing these books for the children. I personally have seen his books. I have read his books. I love them. I think they are great, great stories for a younger generation. Like I said earlier on, and for the people that know, I do have a young child, a boy named Nolan, and I do have a lot of nieces and nephews and stuff like that. And they're about 6, 7 years old, so they're getting into the, I don't want to say the bullying stage, but they're getting into the understanding age. And I think that these books would really help them maybe become a better person, but also to maybe instill some other good values and morals into their friends or the people that they hang around with. I don't know. It's worth a shot. It's a story, you know, so you got to take it for what it is. But as the person reading to your child or your nephew or your grandchild or whatever, you know, you need to show it. You need to demonstrate it also. So don't be a bully to your grandchild. You know, demonstrate what you want your child to become. And I think that's more important than anything else. So again, like Greg said, you guys can get a free copy of his book by going on the App Store. I believe he is also on Android. You guys can go and check out, just search Neon Tiki Tribe on your Android or Apple device. And also to head on over to Neon Tiki Tribe. I believe you can just Google it and it will come on up. Or you guys can go on over to the operationselfreset.com/OSR19. There you will find all the information, YouTube videos, links, everything that we talked about in today's podcast on there. So I appreciate you guys like always, and I will strive and try to, again, get you guys back on a weekly podcast. I appreciate the support. You guys literally are awesome. I could not do it without the support and caring that you guys have, and I know it's affecting you guys out there, because if it wasn't, I wouldn't be receiving anything. Every time I would open my email, it would be crickets, you know? But even still, you know, like I said, I'm not only doing this for you guys, but I truly find passion and great information within these stories that help me, you know, demonstrate good things to my child, you know, make me become a better person and a more loving individual. So I hope that, you know, kind of gets you guys going a little bit too. And one last thing, if you guys really do enjoy this podcast and would like to support it, I do have a nice little offer for you guys. As I spoke of earlier in some other podcasts, I enjoy listening to audiobooks, and I highly suggest you guys, if you don't have the time, feel free to download it on your Android, Apple, MP3 player, on your computer or whatever. I get all of my audiobooks from audible.com. You guys can get a free book, any book, free, 100%. All you have to do is fill out the form. You can cancel immediately after you get your free book, or you can keep a plan or whatever. Just head on over to audibletrial.com/OSR. There you can get any Audible book you want for 100% free. So that's it for today's episode. Again, thank you guys so much for taking the time and listening. I appreciate the support. If you guys have a second, head on over to iTunes, leave a review. And remember, you never know where your life is going to take you. You never know what's going to happen in the future. Everybody wants things now. We want to know, what are we going to do? How much money am I going to make? What's my next plan of action? What's my passion? How am I going to be able to do this or that or whatever? The key is just taking one day at a time, enjoying it the best you can. Things are going to come up, like for myself, the big test, and they will push other things out of the way. I wasn't able to give you guys a podcast, but I knew in the back of my mind I had to come back to this because I knew you guys wanted it. And if you can think to yourself, no matter what happens in your life, if you can stay true to the things that you really believe in, you're really passionate about, and the things that really give you value and you personally love, I love this. I don't get paid for this. This is truly from my passion, my heart, and for me believing in you guys and for you to believe in yourself. And that's the one thing that I truly want to instill into you guys, is that you can achieve whatever you want in your own life. That's all for now. Again, thanks for being you, and we'll catch you in the next episode.